Let's talk to Vortex on the Metal Sucks podcast.
Vortex!
Dude.
What's happening? Man. What's going on? How you doing, man?
I'm good. How are you there?
Good. Sorry we're running a little late, man. I think we got mixed up as far as like what our time zones are. So, yeah, sorry about that.
No problem.
And the other thing is we just had this other interview and like we're trying to wrap up and then the guy goes, and then I got scabies. And it's like, whoa.
Have you ever heard of scabies?
That sounds like a general disease or something.
It almost kind of is in a weird way. It's like.
It sounded like he got them that way. That's for sure.
Really? No. Well, yeah, that's interesting stuff. I'm sure. Yeah, I don't want to miss that.
Yeah, right. So it's great to talk to you, man. The new Arcturus, we definitely want to talk about that. We get so much to talk to you about because you've got so many things that are going on, right?
Too much, yeah, for sure. But yeah, that's good. That's good, I guess. I mean, I have so many fun projects and I try to have time for them all. But some of them are just on hold now they have been on hold for 10 years, some of them, so I guess. When I'm 60. Children are not on hold. They're asleep.
Don't put the kids on hold until they're teenagers or something?
No, they're never going to get on hold, I guess. They're going to be, constantly doing funny stuff that,
Are you getting them, trained on drums and guitar so that way you've got future band members lined up?
Oh, I hope they're not going to grow up to be musicians, actually. I wouldn't want that for them. You know, if they could keep it as a hobby there, that's fine. But, now they're mostly interesting. They like pop songs and stuff like that. And that's totally fine. I'm cool with that. They like Ninja Go and, stuff like that.
But you don't think watching Dad being out there doing it and knowing that you've got to enjoy it, that it's got to be something that kind of would rub off or at least inspire them to want to do something like that, right?
Yeah, Dad's cool.
Yeah. You know what I do? I actually sing annoying songs to them so they don't want to get into music. I have a good strategy there. So, but yeah, they think it's cool when they can watch Daddy on YouTube and shit. That's still cool. So we're just gonna have to see.
How old are they
now? Couple years. Youngest is 4 and the oldest one is 7. So yeah.
Okay. Yeah, they're about hitting that age where you being cool really matters. That's gonna be fun.
Yeah, I hope so.
From somebody whose kid knows that his dad's not cool, I just got to tell you that you got it totally made, man. They're gonna do laundry, dishes.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I know what you mean though, because my mom I don't know even if it's like a Jehovah's Witnesses, but different. So, that wasn't very cool. I know what you mean. So yeah, hopefully I'm going to beat that.
Oh, are you on good terms with mom? Because, what you're doing is the antithesis.
Oh, yeah, for sure. No, we grew over that stage and we're talking to each other. She's coming over for the national holidays, which is on Sunday. So, we're on good terms. We just, don't talk very much about satanic music in that, but
but I don't get that. All right, if she still subscribes to some form of Christianity, I assume, right?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah,
I would assume that, if she loves you, I assume, right?
Yeah, she does. So she's a good mom that way. Yeah,
she doesn't want you to spend eternity in hell. So, right. If I were her. And I'm not, because my name is Godless. I would be on your doorstep every day, banging on that door,
trying to save your soul,
because I love you.
She's constantly putting in, small anecdotes or whatever. She said, "I'm praying for you" and all that, and I'm saying, "Oh, that's just great." And then we'll just leave it at that because I'm not getting annoyed anymore because I know she wants the best for me and. And I'm fine with that. I don't need to have a constant struggle just because we have different views. So I respect hers, but she really doesn't. How Christians are—they're so upwards and down, and they just don't get it. And I don't think she's going to get it now at the age of, you know, 60 plus. So
that sounds like more of you growing up and dealing with that than her dealing with what your beliefs are or where you are.
I guess I just, you know, yeah, I see through the fingers because I see her as a she's a good person, you know, she wants the best, and she just don't get the whole religion thing, and I feel kind of sorry for her, but fuck it, life is so much more than that, you know, just right. With the kids growing up and trying to take care of each other in other ways than, you know, eternity. Yeah.
I'm sure, like, she sees the kids coming along, your kids coming along, and she's like, oh, this is going to change him. He's going to see the miracle of birth, right? You know, all that stuff.
You know, she said the same thing about KISS back in the day. That's, oh, you will grow over this period. Yeah, and, it just never happened. So, yeah. I don't think I'm going to change drastically, like, in the next million years or so.
But she's got to be proud of you. I mean, to have a son who is internationally famous, granted, perhaps not exactly the way she would have.
Not for playing gospel music or anything.
But. Yeah, you know, but she's got to be proud of you on those on that level.
She was, my family is very musical. And, you know, the best part for me when I was a kid was when mom and dad were singing. This was before she turned into like a hardcore Christian. They would sing Mamas and Papas and Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young, and you know, to be on the at my father built a cabin, and we were always there, you know, the whole summer, and they would sing guitar and you know, drink all night, and I used to just pretend to be asleep and just listen to them, and you know, that was, for me, that was just magic. I know she's you know, She's proud in her own kind of, you know, Christian way, but she doesn't talk about it very much. That's fine.
Was there like a moment in her life that you know, looking back on it, you go, yes, that's where it all changed for her because X, she turned into Y.
Oh yeah, yeah. She had her childhood belief, of course, but when Daddy left with his secretary, things got pretty ugly. Yeah, it did. Very classic. So yeah, fucked up. But you know, shit happens.
Were you able to stay on good terms with him?
Yeah, I had to because she gave me the ultimatum after a year or so. That otherwise, I had to apologize to Jesus Christ for, you know, doing voodoo on my sister, who was a great rumor at the time, and, you know, or leave. And of course, I packed my guitar and I had to, you know, I left and I knocked on Daddy's door and he took me in and I was fine. I was, I don't know, 15 or so.
Was like it. That's in the like early days of when black metal is happening.
Yeah,
that's pre-black metal, actually. I guess it was year 91 or something. I think black metal starts in Norway pretty much around, you know, when Mayhem were doing the Mysterious. I guess it still wasn't out yet, but Dartron kind of, you know, changed that whole thing from when they scrapped their second album and just went total black metal instead. You know, that's when the new era starts to count, I guess.
You on the periphery of that, or are you just admiring that, or were you in it?
I guess I was a little too young to be like in the inner of the innermost black circle, you know, but we shared the same rehearsal place as Mayhem back in like before all this happened, when they were doing the Death Crush sessions and all that. So you know, we were admiring them because they were, yeah, they had their leather jackets and they looked totally cool, and you know, we were more into punk and Stooges and whatnot, and we couldn't play. We had like, you know, could do the chords, whatever, but you know, nothing too technical, mushing or anything like that. So, you know, they were always the cool guys, and I went to the first show of when Cadaver and Dartron had a release concert at Elm Street. We were, of course, a bunch of excited kids, underage, I don't know, 17 or so, and it was 18 to get into the concert. But I was, you know, 2 meters tall, so I was the only guy who actually got in. And of course, this for me, it was just, you know, so totally awesome. And yeah, that's that totally inspired me to go, you know, in that direction, I guess.
And that's when you set fire to your mom's church.
That was later.
That was, yeah, it was the day after, actually, I know.
So at this point, the ultimate rebellion for your kids would be to become a musician, but it would be like a Christian black metal band or something of that nature.
No, exactly. No such thing.
Oh, yeah, I guess there's no such thing, even though they, you know, I met people who actually believe there is such a thing, and they, and I can see the way they're arguing, but it really isn't, is it? You know, it's just so corny, but
I've been reading a lot about that lately, and it seems like a really weird, I don't know, there's something really odd about that.
Chuck, you do realize that I could jump as high as I could jump, and I still couldn't high-five Vortex, but I really would want to high-five him. Exactly.
Dude,
right.
Hey, virtual high-five.
Ah, there you go.
Come on.
Yeah, it's such a strange even to try to put those two things together, you know?
Yeah, it's just so silly. We just shouldn't even mention it because then, you know, it's almost like it's, yeah, I don't know. It's really annoying. It really is because the whole scene for us when we grew up, I mean, it was so important to be, you know, true and to be 100%. You know, being so young, with full of issues and you know, it's just full of ignition or whatever. I can, you know, we were so we wanted to do this, you know, 110%, and everybody was trying to, you know, be more true than the other or whatever. And so yeah, it's kind of crushing that whole vision. Spiritually, to put it stupid.
but at the same time, I think that there's a lot of people who have fear of it happening inside the music as much as happening from these outsiders trying to co-opt the, you know, sort of the decoration of it rather than what it really actually means. You know what I mean?
And no idea, buddy. I totally lost you.
Second time today. It's so good.
That's good. I'm just totally knackered. I've been with the kids all day, and they fucking totally run me over, and that's fine. Don't give me anything, you know, it's too deep right now because I just won't follow.
But I guess what I'm saying is, like, you know, with black metal today and what it means, you see people doing all sorts of interesting things with that as the base, Arcturus included. I mean, the stuff that you're doing now, it needed a lot of time from 1993 to now in order to be able to do what it does, right?
I think you're right about that, actually. It's a constant development, progression of thoughts. One thing leads to another, and just to keep it interesting, you just want to evolve, and, you know, not necessarily in the way you thought it would back in the day, but you know, whatever makes it interesting right now, that's what we want to follow, and so we try.
Yeah, and your solo album to me is like is the best of the stuff that you've done, and I thought that what you were doing melodically on that album is. I don't know, sort of leaps and bounds above so much else that's happening within what people would consider at least based in black metal. And I mean, at what point did you know you could sing, and what point did you know you could write melodies like that and had a gift for it?
Wow. Well, first off, thank you, though, buddy. It's well, I don't know. I started playing the guitar when I was 14, I think. Before that, I had a little piano lesson with my grandmother, whatever. And, you know, we just came from this musical family, and they were all singing and, you know, doing their harmonies and stuff. And I always listened, and, you know, I felt it was something really strong. I don't know. I don't know. 14, we started the first band anyway, and I was starting to compose a little. It was all crap, though. Really, I mean, it takes a long while to you know, have your own voice, and I guess that's just for me. It was, though, anyway, just a lot of experience. That one thing led to another again, and yeah, that's just the way it works, I guess.
And please brace yourself for this question, because this might be, I don't know, a tough one to phrase. But all right, so when if you're playing a guitar or you're playing drums, you're doing something very physical that's creating the music. But when you're singing, you're using your breath. It's like it's inside and outside. If that makes sense, it always felt like it's the perfect embodiment of the music. Do you get a sense of that when you're singing? Do you feel distance when you're not and just playing?
I definitely feel inspired when I'm singing. I think that's why, you know, singing on, you know, both in and out breaths or whatever, because I just want to put so much into it. And that was actually one of the things that I had hope I would restrain myself a little bit on this album, The Arcturian, because I think it can be a little too much sometimes, but when I'm in the studio, I just can't help it, because it's so inspiring right there and then I'll just go for it, and then it will turn out, you know, maybe a little over the top, but, you know, just can't help it. It's so much fun.
Now, it's one thing when you're doing that in on the microphone, because you're really, it sounds like you're pushing the boundaries of what your voice can do, you know, like,
yeah,
you're really stretching to get there. I mean,
I think that's the beauty of being an unschooled musician. I just hear the melody lines inside my head, and I don't give a fuck if I actually can reach them or not, because I have no idea of, you know, what my specter really is. But, you know, being a fan of guys like Wharton or whatever, you know, I love them the most when they sing like a drunken sailor, and yeah. I have, you know, I don't care if I sound like a little off or whatever, as long as, you know, the spirit is good. I think that's the most important thing.
But how do you, are you like doing it live though? That's got to be difficult. Cause I mean, I come from a vocal background, and yeah, you know, when you're stretching yourself to that kind of, when you're reaching out that far, sometimes you can blow a gasket, you know? I mean, it can be hard to maintain that night to night when you're stretching that hard.
Yeah. And you know, I'm never maintaining that either. You know, if I, it's 10 days out on the tour, I just won't sound good anymore. And that's fine. That's just how it is. I mean, I don't care. In the studio, I don't think about, you know, oh, this is going to be a problem live, you know. I just think, oh, what would Bruce Dickens do? He would just fucking go for it or whatever, you know. And then I'll just, you know, just push it. And sometimes it works, sometimes it don't. Like on the
Don't think about the mouth cancer. Good.
I don't give a fuck about that. I smoke a lot of cigarettes now, actually. And my grim vocals has improved a lot over the last couple of years for doing that, which is nice. I never thought I would do the grim vocals again, you know, back in 2005 or whatever. But here we are. It, you know, it feels right again.
now when you're singing lead versus when you're singing with somebody else. So in Dimmu Borgir, oftentimes you're singing with Shagrath, right? The singer, and you guys are singing at the same time. Is there like a bond that happens because you guys are, you know what I mean? I know that sounds cheesy. Yeah.
No, but yeah, it is though, because music is like that. You know, that's it will link you together to how matter fucked up things might get at a later stage or whatever, you know. There will always remain this little, you know, band of brothers, to be even more cheesier, you know, because we're out there and doing our shit, and you know, it's up and downs, but you know, those little parts will remain as, you know, the sweet spots in the career anyway.
Hey, how's the lawsuit coming along, by the way?
Oh, dude, that's a long time ago. You know, it's we're still. We went for like a bury the hatches strategy, everyone. After a while, the lawyers just got, you know, really expensive. And I think Mystis is still going on with his suit. But, you know, I just don't give a fuck anymore. I wish we could have come to have something written down on paper more than what we have now. But at least, I'm getting my royalties from Nuclear Blast. And we just don't, you know, we just ignore each other. And that's, that works fine for me, actually.
Well, that sucks that it went down that way, because I guess I was hoping that, like, you know, but I feel like I didn't do this on purpose, but like that idea that, like, you know, you share breath in a way with somebody in the same way you're breathing at the same time, communicating the same thing at the same time, that like that is sort of like this unbreakable bond that will continue. And I thought there's no way they could, like, you know, be nasty about firing somebody as large as you are. I mean, that's got to be scary to do. I mean, they're a bunch of dwarves.
You know what's happened when they fired the first drummer? And that's Jamie, the Australian guitar player. He had to go in and say it to him because I didn't dare. And, you know, they fired us by email, you know, anyway. So that's kind of whatever, you know. Oh, I don't want to sound like to soar or anything like that, because I really don't give a fuck anymore. But, you know, same thing with Nicholas Barker, I guess. You know, they didn't walk up to him and said, you're fired. He's bigger than me, and you don't want to aggravate Nicholas Barker. I mean, I'm just Jesus Christ compared to him, you know.
Man, if I were them, I'd be hiring smaller people going forward. You know, just...
right?
Yeah, and I'd be buying bigger boots, you know, that's the other thing too. I'd have like Gene Simmons like boots, you know, and just, it's firing day, you know?
Yeah, buddy. Yeah, well, they never employed anyone, you know, to be full band members after we were fired anyway. It's all like on the...
Contractors.
Yeah.
Contractors, yeah, pretty much.
Trying to avoid that kind of conflict again.
Yeah,
because, you know, it just might have... I knew they were fighting, like, physically in the studio for the Abracadabra or whatever album. They were. I'll tell you a secret.
Yeah. Oh, so, we're okay. All, wait, no, yes. Don't go anywhere. Tell us.
Oh, yeah, well,
we're all
did,
ears.
You know? No, there was... Yeah, no, I know it was fighting going down in the studio, like, physically. I actually hope for them that, you know, they can get over this. They have a new management now, and this guy is really, really good. I hope it's going to be good for the band, so they, you know, can get the band spirit going again. It will be good for my royalties injection or whatever. Yeah. I don't care, you know. They have kids and families and all that, you know. And a lot of shit happened back in the day, and, you know, it was... I mean, I wish maybe we could be more mature about it, but, you know, it was the Norwegian way. You know, we're just pulling shit under the rug for a long time. And, you know, so we should have gone to like a shrink or something and sorted it out. But, you know, that's not very metal, so it never happened.
Now I know why it's taking so long for the next album. They're all working out and taking martial arts classes.
Getting ready.
The studio.
Battle Royale.
Yeah, totally. That'd be freaking awesome.
Yeah, man. We should tape that stuff.
As long as it's in costume, you know, because it would suck if it's not in costume.
Yeah.
So, costume. When you walk out of that, are you motivated by spite and motivated to... I don't know, creatively
or
business-wise?
Yeah, does it flip around on you, though? Do you want to do something completely different and make it so it's a better experience than that? I mean...
Good question. It's always good for inspiration. It's because it was getting, you know, a little too easy, maybe, you know? You want to have that drive. You want to be hungry for making the perfect album. You know, you want to strive for it. Not just like, oh, yeah, of course, we'll do another album. I don't know, whatever. It's, you know, back in the day with Dimmu, the first albums, they were so inspiring. And we were on the ball all the time. But I think you could smell it on the Insort Diaboli album. It just wasn't that good anymore. Not compared to Death Cult or Progenies. No, I'm sorry. Death Cult, what's ever the album before that? That's
Euphoria. Something. Misanthropy.
Dude, right on.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even the album before that was also super great. You know, Spiritual Black Dimensions, I think it's one of my favorites. You know, I love Jamie and the Naga stuff. You know, it's good stuff. The album before that even. And then, you know, for that time, whatever. Yeah, it was going downhill, and it felt like a sinking ship, and, you know, it didn't come as a surprise that things went like they did, and you know, sometimes that's better, because like you say, it's for the inspiration part. I don't know if it was too much spite, but you know, maybe a little, and that always helps. You know, you want to have that little rebellion thing inside you. That was always good when we were kids, and I think it still stands today.
I'm looking at your lineup of the members of Arcturus, and according to Wikipedia, everybody's under 5'6" and they're a contractor.
Dude, really now?
Who put that in there?
Yeah, you know that
Wikipedia's going to revoke my...
Yeah. Our guitar player, he's a farmer's lad, and you know, he went to Russia, and he could take on Putin, you know, if he wanted. He's that kind of guy. You just don't want to fuck with him.
Let's say sometimes it doesn't matter how tall they are, right?
Yeah, I think my experience is that the smaller they are, the fucking tougher they are. You just don't want to take anyone if they're, you know, they have like another temperament. Usually, I think the taller they are, the more mellow guys tend to get. In my experience, you know, they don't have anything to prove or whatever. You know, just look at Danny Filth. So it's whatever. It's and if you're out in the night, night in town, and a lot of people are drunk, you know, you want to watch out for the small guys, because they will fucking get you.
Flip out on you.
Yeah.
When I was prepping for speaking with you, I was looking at your wife's cartoons, which are funny. And, I mean, she's worldwide, dude. I had no idea.
Oh, yeah. She's a rock star, man.
Yeah, dude, that's pretty sweet. So it's like, you guys are... I first of all, mom must like her more than she likes you, right? All right, beyond that, like her creative process has to be very different from yours, because her output is every day, and your output can sort of be staggered. I mean, it might be a couple of years. I mean, you're putting out an album like all the time, but I mean, it can be a little while if you're not writing a song a day. But is there anything that you've learned from her creative process that you've taken on for yourself?
Absolutely. I mean, she's so structured. I was never structured before we moved in with each other, and I learned a lot from that. She's just hardcore on that. She's constantly working, and I try to learn a little from that. You know, every day, sit down, do something, at least get, you know, maybe a riff or two into the computer, and then at least, you know, it will build. Constantly, and she's just hardcore. She has one strip a day, I think, or cartoon strip. I think she's the most productive cartoonist in the world right now. She has been for years. Yeah, she really is.
I mean, she's got to write something funny every day, and that's super hard to do.
That's really Chuck fucked up.
Yeah. Chuck will tell you, I can't do it once a week.
Yeah, man. I know what you mean. She's just structured is the right word. And,
do you like watch your steps to make sure that you don't end up in everybody's newspaper the following Sunday?
Oh, it's I can't help it. It will just happen anyway. I do constant stupid things, and I'm a constant source for inspiration, I'm sure. Cutting the electricity wires, for instance, with scissors when the shit is still connected, and you know, I do stupid stuff like that all the time, and you know, just to help out, of course.
it's all in just so she has something to work with.
Yeah,
is that like the first thought that goes through your head when you do something stupid? Like, oh,
this check
is
this out.
End up.
Look what I did.
This is, yeah, yeah. No. Or is it like, hey, you know, let's embrace this. This is, you know, I just made your work easy tomorrow.
Exactly.
Yeah, I just say I want tough. Oh, that was my storyboard. No. I know my wife for I don't know 20 years now. I think almost.
Wow. Fuck yeah. That's awesome.
We'll be together, 10 of them. So, you know, it's...
And neither of you have a secretary, so you're in good hands.
Good point. We're both from divorced parents. We have two kids, and you know, if there's one thing we're gonna work as hard as possible to do, you know, we will have quarrels, of course, like everybody. Life is up and down, but you know, you don't want to fuck up for the kids, so you know, you go that extra mile and then another mile, and then you just try to be, you know, build upon on the relationships, you know, put a little love and effort into the everyday life, which is can be hard sometimes, and then you know, just work is a constant work as well, but you know, it's, I fucking love my wife, dude. It's not gonna happen.
That's awesome.
Hail Satan. That's all I gotta say.
Exactly.
Trying to tell people it's metal to love your wife. It really is.
It is, dude.
I think it is.
I love you.
I think Chuck's gonna have to take that out as a drop. We can use it on the air.
Yeah, exactly.
Nobody's ever said that before. It sounded good.
Male bonding. Yeah, that's nice.
Vortex, thank you so much, man. We really appreciate you taking so much time with us.
Definitely,
it's been,
man,
awesome.
My pleasure. You know, anytime, guys. You know, so that's super. I'm glad you wanted me back. That's fine. I actually never been talking to you, but I'm glad. You know, it feels good. Thank you, guys, awesome. So awesome. Much.